tough one last time out in December, right? But a lot of people have tough nights against Amanda Nunes. Give me what you took out of that. I mean, obviously you've been in the game for a long time, but what lessons did you take out of that?
Well, the biggest lesson I learned about myself, you know, that I have to stick to a game plan, and I didn't really stick to a game plan. You know, I came in that night to fight, and she came in not to lose, and you know, I believe I honestly made it easy on her, but I exposed her at the same time, and well, she exposed that I should not be that kickboxer anymore. I should be that MMA fighter. I stood too much tall, and I learned my lessons, but I'm motivated. I'm here, and we'll see.
It's interesting. So does that mean it's been nonstop wrestling camp ever since?
Oh, hell no. Hell no. You got to work on your strengths, of course. You know, I knew what I had to do. I knew I had to stay light-footed. You know, it just... And that's the thing of me. I'm a real fighter, you know. I get hungry. If I knock somebody out, it's almost, you know, I really rocked her on the feet in the second round. I made it, you know, I made it fun in the first round, but I was never in any danger. I mean, I had no damage at all, even after the fight, you know. So, you know, I clipped her in the second round, and I was like, you know, I only have to hit her one more time and I'll knock her out. And I was too hungry. I stood straight up, and just like I did in my kickboxing days, you know, I was able to walk everybody down and knock him out, and unfortunately she did a better job of me, you know. She I did exactly what she wanted me to do, you know, and she laid on top of me and made it a very boring fight, but she got the job done.
Yeah, no question. So it's been, I guess, like 10 months or so since then. Obviously the world has changed quite a bit in the last 10 months, but I was curious, was that 10 months, was that by design? Did you take some time away and wanted to work, or has it been stuff outside of the sport? I know you have interests outside of the sport as well. So, I mean, why the distance between fights?
Well, yeah, you got to ask the UFC. Don't ask me. You know, I wanted to fight, but, and especially, you know, then the time changed with the COVID, of course. And, you know, I have a full-time job as a police officer, and it's my job to help people. And fighting is my hobby. I do this as a hobby. I don't make money with this. I seriously don't. So, you know, I make money doing my job, and my job is to help people. So that's the most important thing first. And now this opportunity came up, and I only took this opportunity because it was safe to take the opportunity. Everything's been taken so great care of by the UFC and all the measurements they took. But if it wasn't been possible because of my colleagues would be out of time, or there would be colleagues, because we have less colleagues now working because of the COVID, because we're getting exposed all the time, or people saying they have the COVID virus, so we have to be in quarantine. So it was a very challenging time, you know. I've been in quarantine, I've never got COVID, God bless, but you know, it was a challenging time because I've been in quarantine and excluded from my family and loved ones a couple times because, you know, I've been exposed to it with people that had COVID. So it was very challenging, but like I said, safety first. And if it was possible for me to come here, I came, and it was possible, you know, and now I'm here.
Nice. What did you think about the matchup itself? But Julian, obviously, you know, she's had some layoffs, like family things, another thing, a highly respected fighter, but hasn't had the results as of late because of the layoffs. So what did you think? Were you a little surprised, or were you excited? What did you think about the matchup?
I'm always excited. You know, I just want to fight. You know, it doesn't matter. A fight stays the same. If somebody has a two-year layoff or one-year layoff, it doesn't mean anything. I expect the best Juliana Peña to show up Saturday. I mean, Sunday morning. You know, I know she has something to prove, and she wants that title shot. So I'm the one to beat.
Nice. Stylistically, it seems like a little bit of a potential nightmare for you. I mean, it could be a tough one for her, or it could be a tough one for you, right? I mean, are you seeing it that way? Is it that simple, the way we look at it from the outside? Like, if you can stay on your feet, she's in trouble. If she gets you off your feet, you're in trouble?
No, I'm not in trouble when she gets me off my feet. No, I'm not in trouble. Did you see the damage Amanda did to me? No, she didn't do no damage. Did she submit me? She didn't submit me. No, this is a fight. Anything can happen. Maybe I submit her. Oh, that would be a nice one. When I hush everybody up, then I promise you, if I submit her, I'll be this. Everybody will be quiet. Anything can happen. This is a fight, you know. If she can knock me out. I mean, this is still fighting. If she catches me, and, you know, this is still fighting, anything can happen. And, you know, it doesn't matter who I face, I fought the best, and they will all shoot on me. So every fight is the same. Even if I fight a stand-up fight, even Holly tried to shoot on me. I mean, Amanda shoot on me, they will all shoot on me. So I fight every time the same fight.
That's awesome. Last thing for me. What are the goals? I know, like, once you know, when you lose a title fight, then you kind of got to start rebuilding and refocus and all that. But I know you just enjoy the competition and love it. So what is the mindset going in? I mean, are you thinking about rankings or what's next or anything like that, or is it just almost just enjoying yourself?
I'm enjoying myself. I mean, rankings don't mean anything. I mean, with all the respect, I'm still ranked number one, and I'm fighting not even the co-main event. I'm fighting the fight before the co-main event on Holly and Reina Aldana. I mean, seriously, the UFC have not really shown me any respect in that kind of way or form. You know, that's the honest truth. I really, really love fighting and the competition. And if they give me another shot, I'll take it. If they don't, I'm fine with just having fun in there. But this is also, you know, me being here tonight is not just me being here. I'm here because I love fighting, but it's also a message for the youth. I mean, I have accomplished everything in my career. I mean, I've been the 10 times undefeated Muay Thai champion. I fought a man. I've been the former UFC champion. Nobody took the belt besides the UFC. And, you know, it was very easy for me to say after the Amanda fight, you know, I lost the fight. Nothing's left for me to do anymore. I mean, I can quit or I can try and go for another title shot. Absolutely. That was easy. But I fight because there's always another day. The sun will come up tomorrow. I didn't change as a person. I didn't change. You know, it's motivating, but I didn't change. Winning and losing is all part of this game. It's all part of life. We learn, you win some, you lose some. You know, and the most important thing is I'm here. And even if I lose Sunday morning, there will be another day.
A lot of people said after your fight with Amanda, you know, that she looked more human than ever. How do you see that? Because if you look at your prior losses, you know, two were for her, you know, and it seems like you were a real challenge for her.
Everybody is human. Everybody is beatable. Everybody is beatable. You know, there's no such thing as, you know, somebody's not beatable. I exposed her. You know, I made it easy on her. I could definitely give her a tougher night, a way tougher night than I gave her. You know, but like I said, I came to fight. She came after the second round not to lose. That's the big difference between her and me.
How do you see she's going to defend again the 145 belt, you know, at the end of the year? And would you go back again in the 145 to the 145 division? And how do you see this fight that she has next?
Well, I mean, yeah, what can I say about it? Who is she fighting again?
Megan Anderson.
That's the tall one, right? That's the tall one. What can I say? I mean, I think the UFC has to sign to make it very attractive, 145 more girls. I mean, she fought the other girl, Felicia? Felicia, right? She fought the other girl, Felicia Spencer, and then you only have Megan. So the only option is Megan. You know, there's nobody else at 145. So, yeah, I think they need to sign a lot of more girls to make that weight division more interesting and also to make it a very interesting weight division.
Well, what do you think of her, like, defending again the 145 belt and waiting until the, you know, to see who's going to be the next challenger?
No, I completely understand. I mean, and I completely understand, you know, don't get me wrong, if Amanda decides, you know, because with all the respect, if Amanda decides tomorrow, this is it, I'm going to quit. I completely understand. If she wants to go and enjoy her family, I completely understand. Remember, she's the one being hunted right now. Everybody hunts for her belt, for any belt she has. You know, she has accomplished everything. She deserves to be in the Hall of Fame, no doubt about that. And she will be in the Hall of Fame. I mean, she has a beautiful family with her wife. I mean, whatever she does, it doesn't matter.
Can I ask you about your shirt? Wear that for a specific reason?
Oh no, I didn't. You like it?
a few comments on it.
Okay, there's no reason I wear this. No, definitely. I like the shirt, so that's why.
Sure.
No, thank you.
And then you mentioned what you learned from the Amanda loss is you have to stick to a game plan. What was the game plan?
The game plan was to be light on the feet, bait her in, because I knew she was going to shoot. The moment I catch her, she was going to shoot. You know, and my coaches during the rounds, they told me, you got to stay light feet, you know, catch her, feint, you know, catch her. And, you know, I stood straight up, flat-footed. You know, I wanted to knock her head off. I'm not going to lie, you know, that's what I wanted. And I'm like, hey, you can tell me whatever you want. I just didn't listen. You know, so there's nobody to blame but me. And, you know, Amanda has an amazing fight IQ. You know, she adapts. She has a great team around her. You know, she has great coaches. She adapted so quickly after the second round. First round, she adapted, but the second round, she thought, maybe we can stand. You know, and then she decided, no, we stick to the plan with her coaches, you know, and she has a great fight IQ, and she executed the job great. You know, there's nothing to say about that.
And one final one. You mentioned you are a police officer back home. In the United States right now, it's pretty divisive between citizens and the law enforcement. Have you been paying attention to that at all, or have you heard anything about that? Or what are your thoughts on what's happening in the U.S. right now?
To be honest, I don't pay attention to it. I'm very busy with my own life and my own job, and my job is to help people. You know, I'm not responsible for any decision any other person makes. You know, I can say that my team, the team I work with my colleagues, we do everything to help people. And I, personally, will always treat a person the way they treat me. I treat somebody the way I want to be treated, with respect and dignity. You know, and that's me. I've been a police officer for 4 years. I've never used any violence, and I hope I will never, ever in my life have to use any violence. And that's it. You know, it's not up to me what other people do, and not everybody is bad. You know, I mean, there's a lot of people that still don't have to forget, no matter what. You know, we all have to work hard in these hard times. Now, sticking together, instead of fighting each other, we have to stick together. I think that's the most important thing, because there's a lot of other things we have to fight than each other.
Can you give us your thought in the main fight between Irene and, you know, Holly?
I suck at predictions. let's stick to that one.
So, right after the Amanda Nunes fight, I saw a really beautiful sentimental moment, and it was you calling your mom.
Yeah.
Like, inside the octagon. Can you talk to me a little bit about the relationship you have with your mom?
Oh, she's my hero. She's, without any doubt, my hero. You know why? Because she's one of the few persons, no matter if I win or lose, I will always stay the same person. I don't change for her. She stood by me for 21 years. Well, 36. But my whole career, she's been there. And the first thing I told her when she picked up the phone was, I lost this fight, but it's okay. And she told me, it's okay. It's okay. It doesn't matter. Are you okay? Is Amanda okay? Of course she asks, is Amanda okay? Seriously, Mom? Is there no other question you could ask? Are you okay and is Amanda okay? I could care less. No. No, it's beautiful. Exactly. You know, she's my hero. And again, you know what she told me also? You got to fight again. And I'm like, yeah, I know I have to fight again. You know, I mean, I'm not done. You know, I'm done whenever I'm done, you know. And, you know, I'm so... She's my everything. I call her every day from Abu Dhabi, and we talk, and I send her pictures, and yeah, I honestly believe it's so important to have that person behind you, that no matter what, you're always be the same person to them, you know. And she is that person for me, and she's a guide, and she's always so positive, you know. And she partly made me the woman that I am today, and I'm forever grateful for all she have done for me.